under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item one on the agenda, are there any adjustments to tonight's agenda? Seeing none, we're going to move on to item two, approval of school board minutes. Do I have a motion?
Yes, I move that we approve the school board minutes as listed in the agenda packet, item 2A, B, and C.
I second.
All those in favor? Thank you. Moving on to item three, comments by student representatives. You have the floor, ladies.
All right, so this week is pretty big in terms of the spirit we've gone on. Typically, spirit week has been held last week before February, but this year kind of assumes a nice break in between the long stretch of March in between February and April. So that's kind of, and spirit week will culminate with an assembly on Friday. As many of you probably know, we'll engage in activities such as tug of war, and I think it's four-way volleyball and cake eating.
Yeah. The theme this year is Avatar: The Last Airbender, so that's
so that's yeah. And also, we had the robotics team won the state championship for the second time, and this is pretty exciting. As an athlete, winning one state championship is difficult, and then to even repeat is, I find personally, even more difficult. And so they're heading to the next. And we also had a student win the Western Maine Conference Citizenship Award, being one of them, Natalie Vaughn.
Yeah. Yay. So, and the other one was Jay Bottomley. So that was last week, I think. Yeah. We also had three alpine skiers make the All-State Maine team. So that was Devin Lathrop, Emma Dvorzniak, and Caroline Packlat. The Model UN delegation that went to the conference at Dartmouth last month, won the team overall won the Best Delegation Award, and Joanne Horn, who's a senior, won Best Delegate, which I think is one of the highest, if not the highest, honors that you can get at a Model UN conference. Last thing is the upcoming NEASC visit, which our whole school is kind of preparing for at the moment. Montana and I are both on the panel/presentation board, that's going to be happening on Sunday. So I'm going to give a little speech, and Montana's going to be on the panel. And then
some of us are being shadowed as well. Yep. I'm one of them being shadowed, where they're just going to follow us through the day. I'm sure all of you know a bunch about NEASC. So.
And then, yeah, there's other students giving tours, other students just being interviewed. So I'm actually really excited. Mm-hmm. Like,
it'll be a new experience, as NEASC, you know, only does it every 10 years, and to be a part of it this year will be pretty exciting. So
yeah. Yeah, that's about it. Yep.
Thank you, Montana and Natalie. Moving on to item five, communications. I believe we have the high school social studies student research. I did want to do item four. I apologize. Comments from public on agenda items. Do we have any? Seeing none. Thank you, everybody. We're moving on to item five for real this time. Social studies, please.
Fantastic. So I am Sarah Harrington. I'm the Social Studies Department Chair at the high school, and I was asked to come tonight to talk to you about our sophomore research project, which culminates in this lovely poster night, which I'm showing slides of. They'll circulate as we go, and we have a few posters around the room, which are sort of showcasing a few projects that happened last year. Thank you so much for having us here. This is sort of a cornerstone of our curriculum, and it really highlights our effort to help students build their vital academic skills, but also to really explore their passions and things they want to pursue perhaps later on in life. And we feel like this is a nice way to blend both of those things, and it really seems to boost several students forward in a very positive way. We're excited that this is our 10th anniversary of this project, which goes to show how long we've been trying to embed this sort of passion projects into our curriculum, and not only passion projects, but projects that really build the vital academic research skills that tend to translate into higher education really well. The summer research project requires students to find and use a wide variety of high quality research materials to uncover the causes of current world problems, the effects of the problems, and possible solutions to the problems. The students self-select their topics, and there's often a very wide range, everything from ongoing Syrian refugee crisis to the colony collapse disorder. And as you can see from our posters displayed around the room, we have elephant poaching over there, cyber war over there, and down here, child brides in Yemen. So a wide variety of topics from all sorts of disciplines. It's a really a chance to employ some cross-disciplinary learning in a very real way, the students' drive. We allow students to explore their passions, which often leads to some great things. Last fall, we had two students who attended the World Food Prize's Global Youth Institute in Des Moines, Iowa, along with their teacher, Ms. Page, and that was all based on their sophomore research work. So it can really be a great way to find something that it appeals to not only them, but will lead them to other successes. And then students synthesize their learning in multiple ways. They write a paper at the honors level. They write a research outline that is a comprehensive research outline with full academic citations at the CP level. And all of them present at sophomore poster night, which is sort of the feature night. Poster night is all sophomore students in one room, the high school cafeteria, which is a bonding experience. And they present their research to their peers and teachers, also alumni and community members. So we solicit what we call judges, who provide feedback to the students, formative feedback on their presentation. And we usually have about 65 official judges. And then because it's right before undergraduate awards night, we often have a lot of families who come through and look at what's going on while they're sort of filing into the auditorium. So we end up with quite a large audience for these students. And so it's become sort of a rite of passage at the high school. And it is a great time to celebrate. Really, a joy of learning comes out in that moment of communal experience. One judge wrote on their feedback form, "I feel like I learn as much as they do just by coming." So we feel like that embodies the night. And so this year's poster night is going to be on Wednesday, May 18th from 5 to 6:30 in the high school cafeteria. And just wanted to sneak that in case any of you are available. We'd love to have you either as judges or just to come by and see what's happening. And I think that it is a really formative experience for students. So I wanted to give Montana and Natalie an opportunity to give you some insight on their experience of it. So ladies, if you want to give a sense.
So this was the first real research paper that I had ever written. And my topic was human organ trafficking in Southeast Asia. So that was fun. And it was definitely, it felt a little bit like it was a big project to tackle, and it was a little bit intimidating, I remember, thinking about it as about halfway through my sophomore year, because there are so many steps that go into it. It is essentially a year-long project, because you start working on drafting your paper back in the fall, and then you kind of go chunk by chunk, where you'll write the part of your paper that's about the problem, and then a couple weeks later, you'll write your solutions. And so it definitely encompasses a span of several months, just the writing of the paper. And then you have to prepare your presentation. And if you look at the poster boards over there, there's graphics that you have to make and charts that you have to explain and images that you have to find. And it does seem a little bit intimidating, at least it did for me. But finishing it, and my poster board didn't look as nice as those did, but it was still like such a rewarding experience. I remember like looking at that and thinking like, this is a legitimate research project, and I felt so like grown up. I was like, this is the first big research project that I've ever done. And it was also really helpful in, I think, my experience with talking to adults and like it being able to explain an issue or a concept to adults, because I had to present to two people, two adults from the community, and I was really scared because I wasn't really all that used to talking to adults, especially those who I didn't know at that point. So that was definitely, you know, being able to pull off that presentation and actually feel confident about it and feel like I was having an actual conversation with an adult, like as an equal, not you know, not them talking down to me, but my being able to explain a problem and a solution to them was really fun. So that was definitely really beneficial.
I would just like to second basically what Natalie said in terms of speaking to adults, and it definitely improved, I want to say, presentational skills when referring to documents behind me and whatnot, and being able to explain what I was saying multiple times. I was encouraged in the class that I was in not using filler words. In addition to that, I found that this research project really reinforced, like Ms. Harrington said, the revision process, because I remember having multiple revisions of papers, and like my paper at the end was probably about this thick and having gone through it many times. And one of the things that came through during the revision process that I've taken with me over the years is definitely, and I feel other students have taken it with them as well, would be the MLA citations, which was a very big part, because plagiarism is a big deal, and making sure that we give the right information to sources, and all of our information obviously is coming from so many different sources, and being able to cite that correctly was probably one of the most insightful things that I learned during the poster presentation and project, because I'm always going to have to cite work from here on out, and I still find myself referring to this some of the resources we used during this project. So.
The other thing that I just realized I didn't mention was just basic research skills. And the next time that I remember doing as big an amount of research as I did for the sophomore research project was for my policy paper junior year. And I think for both of those projects, you had to have, I don't remember what the specific numbers were, but you had to have a certain number of online sources, encyclopedias, like magazine articles, like journal entries or scholarly articles, some charts or graphs or like visual data. And there was a big checklist of sources that you had to be able to find and use and interpret. And that is really helpful, because I think we tend to get really caught in the trap of just Googling everything. I know I do this, is if I feel like I need to research, I just immediately just Google it. And like I think a lot of people start thinking if it's not on Google, it's not helpful or I can't access it. And as a sophomore, you know, I mean, I'm now thinking about college and I wasn't as a sophomore, but now I'm like looking back and really grateful for the experience that I had with developing basic research skills, both in this project and in my junior year policy paper, because that's something that's going to be really helpful next year for me.
So we really consider this project student-driven, teacher-guided learning done right with clear standards and with continuous feedback from caring teachers, and a great way to sort of usher kids into serious research on an academic level and to explore something they're passionate about and find out more about it. So we would invite you to consider coming to our upcoming poster night this year, and we're happy to take any questions you have. Thank you.
I just have a question. So in terms of the presentation, each student presents to one or two adults and, along with their physical product. Is that what there is? Mm-hmm.
Correct. Yeah, there's two sort of official judges, we call them. But they're asked to present to whomever asks them to present. So those wandering parents and community members.
All at the same time?
Yeah, it all goes on at the same time, which can be a little hectic, but is also a good sort of communal experience. Everyone sees everyone doing these presentations, and it's a great time to practice those hard things like, what do you do if you don't know the answer to the question the adult has just asked you, and how do you gracefully, you know, move on? So all of those are experiences they get.
I've been to a couple of these nights, and it's fantastic. The kids are so excited for you to ask them about their research project. They look really nervous, but they're so approachable and so willing to share all of their work. It's a really cool, I would encourage you guys to go if you haven't been before.
Bye.
I was just going to say, I'm impressed. There's a lot of explicit instruction that goes on with a project like this, from oral presentation to research to citation to writing. Is there any collaboration with English at all on this, or is this all taken on by social studies?
Well, the English department obviously reinforces all of the skills that we are pulling into this project. And many students experience at the ninth grade level an iSearch project, which is really their first experience kind of pulling a diverse amount of sources together. So they really do get exposure at that ninth grade level with the iSearch project. And then they have continued exposure through their English courses. Yeah, absolutely. So they reinforce the message that we're pulling here. Yeah.
Well, sign me up to be a judge. I think that's
thank you. Mark one down, guys. Thank you very much.
Are you still looking for judges?
Absolutely we are, yes.
Is there a way that community members who may be watching now could
absolutely
tweet you?
Yes, or? They can contact me, Sarah Harrington at Cape Elizabeth Schools. Yeah, and we'll put them on the list.
So they just go to the department website and then go to the high school tab and then go through to staff and email directory, I think is probably the best way to find you.
Correct. Yes.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's really exciting.
I would just like to add, I know the school board often meetings talks about the strategic plan, and the perception can be, you know, we have to do things differently or why aren't we doing this? But I think this is a great example of recognizing that so many things that are in the plan we're already doing, you know, project-based learning. You obviously hit on a lot of those, directed learning, you know, pursuing their passions, having to think critically. So I think it's very helpful to the school board to be reminded at times a lot of things already going on in the district, and rather than always the messages do something differently, it's important to celebrate that a lot of that's already being done, especially for 10 years. So thank you for the presentation.
Thank you. Item B, we're going to have a strategic plan update. It's in the form of student achievement update from Rebel and Vaughn.
So this is typically the time of year where we have presented our student achievement updates, but as you know, last year was a pilot year for Smarter Balance, and Rebel will certainly elaborate on that, but we didn't receive the data back. She didn't wait for the issue for us to receive the data back. So she's going to provide you with a snapshot of some data points that we do have available and talk to you a little bit about the assessment process that will be taking place this year.
Good evening. I'm going to start with an overview of, as Meredith said, some of the data points that we do have in district that we trace across longitudinally, and then I'm also going to visit our upcoming state assessments and where we're going with those. Probably the data point that we have the most years back would be our SAT scores for the high school. And I've given just past 4 years. This gives, and actually I need to open this up a little bit and see if I can be seen. Doesn't want to show you the whole thing at once. Well, we'll look at this piece and then we'll move over. starting with the most recent on the top row, you can see that, wow, Cape Elizabeth has been considerably higher than both the state and national averages, and continues to be. There's been a little bit of bounce around. The new SAT is being given this fall, starting this month. The state test that we will see in April will be the new SAT. So the data points aren't completely comparable. The College Board has done longitudinal studies for us so that we can compare what we see from results this year to what we have in the past. But if we're comparing past state assessments like NECAP or Smarter Balance, we don't have those correlations at this time. We won't be seeing NECAP correlations, Smarter Balanced. Might be in the works. We're still thinking about it. Our PSAT scores, and this is just very large. It's not wanting to, let me see if I can get this smaller. PSAT 10 and PSAT 11, these are this past fall scores. And I think the telling piece here is the ERW is our English reading writing score, and then the mean math score. If you look at the percentage that met benchmark, 96% of students who took it met the grade level benchmark for English reading and writing, 70% for math, and that held true both for the 10th grade and the 11th graders. They were very similar data points. We are looking at changing some of our alignments in math across district. We've been doing some work with math consultants, Professor Mahesh Sharma, and also Professor Gina Kling, and they've been working with us on our alignment points, on our progressions of coursework, and we are in process meeting as a district team to finalize what that will look like for next fall. The NWEA assessment we have kept at the middle school, primarily as a historical data point because we've had so many shifts in our state testing. It's the one test that we've had consistently back to NECAP, through Smarter Balance, through the next iteration, so that we have the one piece that's the same from year to year. We get a number of different data points, and rather than to try to give you a small packet of here's NWEA, I did look at the percentage of students that were at or above grade level expectations. And for last year, math and reading scores are there. This year, they are slightly elevated, but not statistically significantly different. We are looking at those shifts and anticipate that our math should be going up in the next couple of years. The data points we have from NWEA are pretty close to what we see from our STAR assessments as well. STAR we've only had in district for the last 2 years. It is the one test that we have that spans grade levels. We start at kindergarten with early literacy in STAR. I've given you data points for comparison for grades 3 through 8. We do also use it in the high school as a progress monitoring if we have a student that we have concerns about, but it's not used as a universal screener at the high school level.
Can you just describe a little bit, and we have some numbers, but the difference between NWEA and STAR?
Yes. NWEA, both tests are computer adaptive tests. Both tests will self-level to where the student is answering. They are both aligned with Common Core standards. The difference with STAR is that it's also used as it uses a universal screener, which means everyone takes it and then we can see where our students are on the continuum, who's needing enrichment, who's needing intervention. And then for STAR, we can also use it for what's called progress monitoring. We can test as often as once a week. We don't typically test once a week. That's a bit much. But we can test more frequently, say every 4 to 6 weeks, if we're using an intervention with a student to see if that student is making the progress that we need him or her to be making. We can't do that same piece with NWEA. This is a fairly short test as standardized tests go. It takes somewhere between 20 and 35 minutes or so, sometimes 40, depending upon the student. It's not a timed test, but it gives us data on the continuum of standards, where a student is, not only by grade level standard, but also this student has mastered this at this grade level, but this standard is at this grade level. So here's where the holes are, and here's our next points of entry to improve. So it really gives us deeper levels of information to really target students' instruction.
I would just add that when we selected STAR, we had looked at research from the National Center for Response Intervention, and their clearinghouse analysis showed this to be kind of the highest ranked assessment in both reading and mathematics with the greatest sort of reliability and validity. So,
And it's fairly easy for the teachers to administer and to use the data from as well, which is another very big important point. There's no sense testing and collecting data if we're not actually going to use it to inform instruction. For STAR, our math scores, these are students who are at above projected benchmark of proficiency. The test dates between Pond Cove and the middle school do vary a little bit. Pond Cove has tested fall, winter, and will test in the spring. The middle school has done fall testing and will do selective testing in the spring for students they want data going into next fall for. Our reading scores between the two assessments, between NWEA and STAR, are very correlative. They're almost identical. The math is a little bit higher for NWEA than it is for STAR. And I think part of that may be reflected in the fact that STAR digs a little bit deeper in some of the depth of knowledge questions that it asks. They're all multiple choice, so they're not asking constructed response, but there are questions that students are asked to think a little bit more to be able to answer multiple layers on, and that makes a little bit of the difference there in the two math scores. The report summary that you have, and it's going to be a little bit tougher to see here. Those of you who have it in front of you, it's a little bit easier. By grade level, what I have up here is the aggregate for the school. This is broken down by grade level so that you can see this is grade 3 on top, grade 4. Levels 1 and 2 are considered less than proficient. Levels 3 and 4 are proficient. 4 would be correlated with our proficient with distinction on former state testing.
Ellen, just one other clarification.
Sure.
It says student performance outlook on the May 2016 MEA, so it's predicting
students
to perform on the assessment being delivered by the state of Maine in May based on the Maine/Common Core standards.
Correct, yes. And as these scores are predictive, we'll then look to see where we actually end up when we get our scores for the test. Any questions on this part? I'm not going to try to read all of the figures to you.
Do these scores lead you in any particular direction, if they're moving any particular way? I mean, so are we just taking the vital information? And so how do these translate into what, what actions we might be taking?
Certainly prefer to use these as diagnostic rather than an autopsy. Mm-hmm. Looking to see, particularly in math, as we have changed our series, updated at Pond Cove to the new Everyday Math series, as we're making shifts at the middle school, looking to see how that's impacting our overall trends moving up, Typically, you do see an implementation dip as you implement new things. It takes a little bit of time to get the bugs worked out, and then everything comes up. So far, we haven't seen a large dip. We're seeing kind of flat with a slight upward trend. I'm hoping that means that we're not going to have too much of a dip as we go. Individual students, certainly these pieces give us a lot of information about how to tailor to a particular student's needs. A student might be very strong in math overall, but as we start to dig through the scoring, there may be a particular strand that is not as strong, and that tells us this is where we need to make sure that that hole is filled before the student moves on. As we look at program across the board, it gives us information if a particular cohort was here last year and has actually lost ground comparatively speaking to its other, to the other cohorts moving forward. That gives us pause to look at program. It helps us to look at the instructional pieces. What's the pedagogy being used? Where do the shifts need to happen? I don't know if that fully answered your question.
I would just add, John, that I think, you know, it's a challenge for us right now, NWEA being the data that we have, again, as Ruthellen pointed out, the most longitudinally right now. We have had curricular shifts in terms of Common Core standards expectations and in terms of the state assessment. And typically it's 3 to 5 years before you can really make any projections about data trends. So we are, you know, are working with some predictors, but without a really clear picture, I would say, of where we're headed, at least in terms of this data. I think what it is most useful for is projecting what can we do for individual students right now. That's how we're using it primarily.
Mm-hmm. Usually when I see this sort of broad data like this, which is essentially sort of bell curve kind of data, what I'm always interested in is what is happening at the top end to keep that top end improving and mm-hmm. those folks challenged, and what are we doing to move up the people at the lower end. And the middle will generally tend to take care of it itself, and that also has a lot of momentum to the middle, and it's actually the hard one to change. So if you could speak
and
to
I would
the
say
top
that,
end and the lower end, and if it's instructive for what's happening. And
sure, and those are not new challenges for us. Mm-hmm. You know, our historical data has typically said, ooh, we need to pay attention to both of those ends. And so at the lower end, we really looked at our response to intervention system over the last few years. At the higher end, I know the board's aware that we implemented our gifted and talented programming, essentially introducing a gifted and talented consultant on a regular basis to the district last year and continuing that this year to be able to provide support to teachers and stretching students at the upper end. And that really was part of the impetus along with teacher input for the differentiation training that we've and support that we've provided to teachers. I think that said, it's also a very much a part of the work of evaluation on the part of administrators and helping teachers look carefully at that data in data teams and grade level teams to sort of examine how are we doing for all kids, because that's what we have identified as a goal in this district. So we're working. Again, these particular pieces aren't giving us clear pictures, but it is systemically looking at how can we move all kids forward along the trajectory.
To give you an example, one of the reports that we do get from STAR gives not only the percentile for a particular student, but where that student is in regard to growth with academic peers across the country. And so we might have a student who's in the 99th percentile and has remained in the 99th percentile, but hasn't really shown much growth relative to peers, and that tells us this student needs more. He's doing okay, but he's not. He was high and he's still here, but he should have jumped here. And so what else can we do to support that? That's where we can dig down.
And that's happening.
That is happening, yes.
That's the thing I'm interested in.
Maybe just share, Smarter Balance. I guess it came and went, and there's all different, you know, SAT, NWEA, STAR, there's MEA, lots of acronyms, but from the teachers in the classroom, what tools, which one of these can they use on a real-time basis? Because the thought is if you give one assessment into the, it's already happened, you know, if it's at the end of the school year or, you know, the standards may change. So which one, you know, who knows what the next one's going to be, but which one are we hitching our wagon to that teachers say, you know, I'm starting to see how this can help me impact students, you know, next week, not, you know, by the way, the longitudinal, you know, 4 years from now,
right,
they're doing better. So help us understand that.
I would say of the assessments that we have, STAR is probably the one that gives us the most of that information. Once a student finishes that test, his score is up immediately. And so reports can be generated within 30 seconds of finishing that test. We then have the opportunity to dig in, and as I said, it can be given as often as once a week, although I don't recommend it. And so it gives that opportunity for checking to see what's working, what isn't working, particularly in interventions, or if we're looking at a student who is getting some enrichment, what is that doing for that student's progression? So. And then our next segue is into the assessments that we have coming up. We have the main educational assessments, the MEAs that last year were smarter balanced and have gone by the wayside. MEA has not gone away. Our new tests this year are referred to as Empower Me and the new SAT. The Empower Me test is the one that's least familiar. It's a brand new test, but it's a product of Measured Progress that is not a brand new company. Measured Progress did our NECAP for years, and they did NECAP for New Hampshire and Rhode Island before Maine jumped in. And they have been doing this for years and years. A lot of the concerns that were raised last year around the Smarter Balance test, security issues, data concerns, that sort of thing. Measured Progress has been doing this for a long time without those concerns having been raised. Measured Progress and the DOE are working on correlations to last year's Smarter Balanced student tests, the PSAT and the SAT, so that we will have some longitudinal data from last year, this year, so that we can do a little bit of apples to apples comparison. We have been assured that it won't be used for any type of accountability pieces from the state. It's just to help us see where Smarter Balanced fit in with what isn't happening anymore and what will be happening. The Empower test, and it's the MP is capitalized because it's Measured Progress and ME is for Maine. It will be a shorter test than the Smarter Balanced test was, which is always happy for people to hear. And because it's a shorter test, and because of the way that it's configured, students will have more access to instructional technology in grades 3 through 6 during the testing window, rather than our having to shift cards, and so everything is in this building and these kids don't get access to here. We're going to have more opportunity to do shifting, so they may test in the morning, but they're still available for classroom use in the afternoon. So it's not removing the technology completely from those classrooms for that window. It is Common Core state aligned, state standards aligned, and there will be correlations, like I said, to the SAT and the ACT, the PSAT. The new SAT will be a school day administration. It will not be on a Saturday this year, so it will be during the regular school day. It can be reported to colleges as a regular SAT with a couple of exceptions, but they're very, very small. There are 2 or 3 accommodations that might negate that option. If there's a concern, you can certainly have a talk with your child's counselor, but it's not likely that that's going to affect many, if any, of our students. The College Board has a proven track record of test and student data security. So again, some of the concerns that were raised around Smarter Balanced, they shouldn't raise their heads this year. And again, this is a Common Core state standard aligned exam. We've been told under no certain terms to make sure that we do not try to compare the 2013-14 NECAP and the old SAT to the Smarter Balance because they are on separate sets of standards. So studies are being conducted to allow us to look at Smarter Balanced, the new Empower Me test, and the SAT, so that moving forward we'll have some longitudinal data, but we don't get to go backwards. So I guess life starts last year, but really this year, because Smarter Balanced is being kind of joined in as a footnote. Federal accountability programs will not use the data points for comparison. They won't be used for identification of schools for sanctions. So schools that were identified using the 2013-14 NECAP test are still in limbo. Everything has been frozen and will be until 2017. So everything remains the same as it was, and we wait for the next year's testing, and because this year again will be that benchmark, they're setting the standards. However, because we will have the correlations to the SAT and the PSAT, it's a very important year for us to be able to see that trajectory, and so it's still very important data for us. Even though it's just a benchmarking year, it's an important benchmarking year because we know that it's data that we're going to be able to see some correlations with, as opposed to it's just kind of hanging out here. So that's a good thing. Our testing window and schedule, whoops, sorry. The fact it is a shorter test for the Empower test. It will be less than 6 hours in total, and it's over 4 days for each grade level. The SAT is clocked at 4 hours and 22 minutes, and that will be given in 1 day, but it's 1 day and it's done. And I believe that does include a little bit of the break time in between testing as well. They look at that as pencils up to pencils down. So our testing dates, our testing dates will be March 29th through April 8th at both Pond Cove and the middle school. The high school test date is April 12th, and the makeup for their exam will be on April 27th. There are sample questions available for the Empower Me test for those who would like to take a look to see where that's going to go. The questions that have been released are very few because it's a fairly new test. So it's not a particularly deep sample, but it gives a small idea of what it might look like. There's selected response, which are the multiple choice questions, constructed response, writing either a short paragraph or a lengthier essay, and then the evidence-based selected response is where students are asked to compare documents or to compare information from multiple sources and then answer multiple choice questions. So it's a deeper level of knowledge that's being tested rather than just read one passage and answer questions. It's multiple passages and compare. Brief word about opt-outs, because this did come up for us last year. We are required to have at least 95% participation rate for accountability by Maine statute and state law. We did receive a warning notice from the DOE this year regarding our participation last year. Sanctions could include curtailment of federal funding if participation does not return to historic averages. I'm really not anticipating that we're going to have the issues that we did last year. SAT is something that most are looking at as, yes, this is something that we're going to be taking anyway. For the Empower Me test, the fact that we do have correlations to those other tests that are already valued, the fact that we're working with a company that hasn't had the history of issues that were concerns that were raised about Smarter Balanced, I'm pretty confident that this is going to be back to testing as usual. I'm hoping so. If there is an opt-out that happens, it does need to be in writing, received by the school office 3 days prior to testing, and give reasons for the opt-out. Next steps for testing, we're looking at this summer, standards test, standard setting for proficiency levels, benchmarks, cut scores for this test administration. A year from this spring, we hope to have the links from to the PSAT and the SAT correlations. Again, next year, we should also be getting links to Lexile and Quartile scores, which are reading and math levels that we get on some of our other tests as well. NWEA provides Lexiles and Quartiles, as does STAR. Those give us a reading level for the Lexile. What is the approximate reading range for a student? And by getting those Lexiles and Quartiles on another test, it also gives us another data point that we can correlate the scores, the tests that we're already using in district. So this is pretty exciting because it's one of those really solid links that we can start looking at our data and making sure that we have multiple data points that we can base our decisions on. Question?
It's been years since I had to worry about an SAT. What's the difference between the new and the old SAT, and are the tests themselves at all like the STAR tests?
They are not computer-based. They will still be paper pencil, at least for this year. Primary changes are around the types of questions that are being asked. There will not be vocabulary that's just in isolation. Analogies have been gone for a while. It will be more use in context. And so students will be asked similar type questions, but in a way so they'll read it and they'll have to infer. There's more questions that dig into the meaning of, rather than just an isolated, have you seen that before and can you pull it from a hat? For the math, there are fewer pieces that are necessarily just straight arithmetic, but there's also fewer pieces that are geometry-based. There's more algebraic thinking that goes into the test, and students are also not being penalized for guessing anymore. There's not a penalty for wrong answers. So it used to be students were, if you couldn't narrow it down, don't guess. Now it's answer.
I would say I can share some links with the board if that would be helpful about some of the changes that the College Board has made, but I would encourage you also to visit the College Board website for some of the explanations that they have. They give some good examples of some of the types of questions that students are being asked to answer. And I would just remind folks that anyone can set up a Khan Academy account for the SAT. You can answer a few questions, and it will sort of say, oh, here are some skills that you might want to practice. Yeah. And anyone can have free access to prep for the new SAT. Mm-hmm. The new SAT is also going back to a 1,600-point scale,
yes,
back to sort of the old way when some of us may have taken the SAT. Where reading and writing are combined again. There is an optional additional essay component, but where you get a combined reading writing score as well as a mathematics score. And we will have the ability at the district level and school level to be able to really sort of dig into that data and look at, oh, a student, you know, got a, you know, 612 on mathematics, but let's really look at where they did well and where they had some challenges. So you'll be able to look really in a similar way that we've been able to do historically with NECAP at sort of line item detail for released items to say, oh gosh, the students need some more practice with geometry concepts, which I think is really helpful to us instructionally, and we'll also be able to do that. And we proposed in the budget being able to continue with PSAT in grade 9 and 10 as well as in grade 8 since the state no longer pays for those, but we think that longitudinal data will also really help us in sort of aligning instruction to meet standards but also to support students as they prep for their futures.
Thank you. Joe?
Yes, so a few questions. Around the testing for grades 3 through 8, what is the length in comparison and the time out of the classroom compared to not the assessment from last year, not the Smarter Balance, but whatever it is we had before that.
Before, it's very similar to what we had before with the NECAP.
Okay.
It is.
Yeah, two reading and two math sections, mm-hmm. each about less than an hour, so.
Right.
Yeah.
So no extraordinary measures of taking away class time and none of that?
It will be very similar to what we had seen for at least the 7 or 8 years leading up to Smarter Balance.
That's a relief.
Yes.
Another question. So the PSAT that the students took last fall mm-hmm. as sophomores, was that based on the old SAT, or is that a PSAT that helped them get an idea of what the new SAT was like?
That's the newer PSAT.
The most recent PSAT is based on the new SAT. Mm-hmm. And then just to sort of, I know that there's an asterisk about whether the SAT can be reported to schools, mm-hmm. and there's, can you tell us a bit more
sure.
about that? It seemed like that was the win-win bonus of administering the SAT.
It is, and there are, I think there's the one accommodation that would negate being able to be reported. It would count as a state test, but not as a test for
college admission.
If a student has someone who is reading the test for them for the reading portion, if there's ASL interpretation, because it's ASL is the one piece, because ASL is an interpretive.
Right, it's not
word. It's not interpretive, it's not a direct translation. So because of that interpretation, if it is ASL translated, it negates being able to report it. I don't know that that's going to be an issue for any of our students, but we were told to make sure that
it's not our testing protocols per se.
No, not at all. It would be those one or two accommodations that would negate it. And it would count as far as our participation, it would count for state testing, but the College Board would not report that for college admissions.
For those individual students?
Only those individual students who had that. Yes. And I've spoken with the counselors. It doesn't look like we're going to have any, but you don't know who may move in the next 2 weeks. So.
And if they do, they do. That's
they do. That's right. Yep.
Going back to the STAR reports,
mm-hmm.
or the MEA reports, I had a question around the middle school math
mm-hmm.
anticipated outlook for the May 2016. I'm noticing that there's sort of a trend in less than proficient rises, the percentage of less than proficient rises in the grades, but then the percentage of proficient declines as the grades go on. I'm wondering if you can attribute those trend lines to any particular change in curriculum in math, or is there a reason for those trend lines, or?
We only have 2 years of data, so I'm hesitant to call it a trend line yet. I'm cautiously optimistic that some of that is because we have done some more intensive intervention to help kids meet that trajectory.
Mm-hmm.
But 2 years worth is tough to make that as a yes,
I'm just
this
interested
is a program
because
change.
There's sort of the comparison of cohorts.
Right, right.
Is what I'm looking at as a trend. And that,
okay.
And that interesting.
Hopefully, yes. But to be able to say that it's this one piece, we have only just introduced a new math series at the elementary level. Our changes are still in process at the middle school. So I'm hesitant to say that there's a direct correlation there.
Excuse me. So I just have a quick comment on participation that was touched on. So I think that we should probably have a problem with participation in the future because last year when students heard of the opt-out, it kind of spread like a disease throughout the high school. And the fact that it was also on a Saturday, I think, helped with that. Mm-hmm. And that some were under the impression that it didn't necessarily count. And I would say that as I would ask that we keep the SAT during the week throughout the future, because that will definitely ensure high participation rates throughout the future.
And I think that's part of the state's agreement with the College Board as the vendor for the SAT delivery is that it be held during the school week for, yes, for exactly that reason, based on their experiences nationwide. Great point, Joe.
Mm-hmm. I just want to clarify. So you, on the slide, we were talking about stakes and non-comparability.
Mm-hmm.
What are the stakes? High stakes or low? Can you describe what those are so that we understand?
Yes. Once there is accountability, once we're not in that frozen period, we are assessed on the percentage of our students who are making proficiency, and that is expected to go up.
Yeah, I was just to say, bearing in mind that there may be some changes in how the state is determining that accountability because of the ESSA changes that are looming. So we don't know exactly what those rules they will select will be.
Yeah. In the previous regulatory regime, that
yes,
we knew that there was relatively rigorous standards around testing and improvement and a baseline, and
yes,
we just recently established a baseline. We then changed that so we don't have a baseline, and now we don't know exactly what the stakes will or won't be, but there will, right, be something around measuring proficiency.
That is correct.
Right.
Okay.
What we do know right now is that there is an expectation, as Ruth Ellen pointed out, for that participation rate, and that we are assessing 95% of our students, and the stakes for that are actually quite high because it could impact federal funding.
Got it. And then on the sort of shifting the test regime, we're sort of new baseline now.
Correct.
The data that we'll get, we can pass correlate some that will be helpful for diagnostic purposes, but has no basis in any sort of other regulatory process.
Correct. Okay. It will
so
not affect.
Now back on track to have,
right,
comparable data year to year to year.
Yes, it will not affect accountability at this point, and hopefully this will be the last change for a while, and we'll be able to say this is where we're staying. And I think that's a lot of the reason why the state went with Measured Progress and College Board, and the fact that the two companies are willing to work with one another bodes well.
That's helpful. Thank you.
We'd like assessment to remain focused on learning.
Yes.
Or what?
We'd like assessment to remain focused on learning, you know, student learning.
Well, and have useful year-to-year data,
yes,
that informs the decisions you're making.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Any further comments?
Just a quick, Ruth Ellen, and that back to STAR again, because I think that I appreciate the only 2 years of data piece, and I hadn't realized before that STAR was sort of like student performance outlook on the MEA thing, and I'm curious about the apple and orange nature of a STAR calibrated standard reference test,
mm-hmm,
and NWEA is a little more norm referenced. And
STAR has about a million, when we selected it, had been referenced by about a million students and folks across the state, so the National Center for Response and Intervention does have that data, and it has been correlated with standard achievement rate assessments as well.
I was just going to say, I mean, the bottom line really is we're looking in a micro way, you want to see how individual our kids are doing. In a macro way, we want to see our percent of proficiency going up.
Mm-hmm.
And my question, my bottom line is, how dependable is the STAR compared to standards? So I'll be interested over time to,
right,
to really see how that proofs out for us, because that has resource implications, it has strategy implications, and so it seems a little bit unclear to me, and I'm sure to you, how that's all going to come out. But
we need a couple more years,
yeah,
to be able to really get a good trend line.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So far, at least at the student level, the correlations seem to be fairly good.
Mm-hmm.
At the program level, we are still waiting.
That's fair. Thank you.
Okay. Just before we wrap up, I would like to suggest either at the district level or at the building level, some communication to parents about, especially the Empower Me, given the level of discomfort,
yes,
that was among parents about the security and the data and other difficulties that
that's
arose
the point
with
that I
smart
forgot.
Balance, and so I would just...
Letters are going home this week, okay, yes.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Set yourself up for success.
Trying to.
Great, thank you. And so moving from sort of a district perspective onto a PONCO perspective, I think we're going to start with Principal Hassan.
And I want to thank you for doing this work and showing us some early release options.
Well, thank you. We actually have, there's a few staff that wanted to speak very briefly. They were intending to speak at the start of the meeting, but we're told it was better to speak just before I spoke. Is that
wonderful?
Okay.
Yeah. So we'll have Mr. Shaltrick.
Who's supposed to be lip syncing right now, so he's going to go.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
I'm supposed to lip in the name.
Oh,
okay. Good evening. My name is Thomas Sheltre. I'm the technology integrator at Pond Cove Elementary School. This is my third year at Pond Cove and my 12th year in education. In my previous 2 years at Pond Cove, technology PD in our building consisted of Tech Tuesdays that were on my own time to show up at 7:30. And to offer teachers time if they wanted it. The Tech Tuesdays were 45-minute sessions, 7:30 to 8:15, held in the Creation Station, formerly the Computer Lab. These were attended by, an average of 2 staff members per session. And rightfully so, 7:30 in the morning. You know, I'd had to leave my 6-year-old earlier than I wanted to, and so I completely get it. I did send out a few surveys about time and about what would be the best use of our time and that kind of thing, and still only about 2 or 3 people at the most. This year, with the introduction of our half-day PD sessions, Kelly Hassan and former assistant principal Julie Nickerson actually granted me monthly 45-minute tech PDs during that half-day time. And this is where all the building staff were attended to require, because they were there anyway for the half day. In anticipation of the new PD model for technology, I surveyed the staff last year in May about what they were most interested in doing for the upcoming year. On that survey, I put 10 items on a scale of 1 to 5. Those items included everything from Twitter to creation apps to what I call sit and get apps to a lot of other things. And then the one that won with the highest score, the highest average score with a 4.2, was planning with tech in mind. And that's what the staff really wanted to focus on this year. So that's what we did. And I do have, I'll reference a lot of surveys. If you're interested in seeing those at all, I'm more than happy to share them with you. I just put little average formulas under each column to kind of guide the way that I went from there. I spent some time this summer planning my yearly PD, knowing that I had a master plan, but that I was still going to use surveys to find out what the staff needed the most when it came to technology and when they needed it. So I had this plan, planning with tech in mind, but every single PD, before the PD happened, I sent out a survey to double check with people, and after the PD happened, I sent out a survey to get their results back, what they thought of everything to help drive my instruction. I made that a large part of my 45 minutes and reminded them to be as brutally honest as necessary, because I wasn't going to get any better leading a PD unless they were honest with me about how the PD sessions went. We started the year trying to integrate technology PD into our community PD day, which was our first PD moment of the year for my first 45 minutes. I spoke to the staff about the first tech night of the year, which was around the topic of digital citizenship, how it impacted our students at Pond Cove, and how it impacted them as teachers as well. Second 45-minute PD session, which was offered on October's half day, I sent out the survey, like I said, ahead of time, asked the staff, would you like to get back on track with planning with tech in mind, or would you like to move into something else? And one of the options was the new curriculum I was rolling out called the iCan iPad curriculum that I kind of created, and we rolled out as far as the iPads in the elementary classroom is concerned. And the staff voted for that to be the 45-minute topic, because they weren't sure what it was, and we all wanted to get on the same page. For our November session, I went back to the survey from the previous year and concentrated on planning with tech in mind. In particular, what's on our iPads? Let's explore. How could we look at something a couple weeks from now and take the time and put that in there. And staff is always given a little bit of what Jonathan Werner calls sandbox time. So time to play at the end to make sure that they can utilize some of the things. And it's not just a 45 minutes rush to the end and then you don't get any time to play with it afterwards. In January, this is the one I'm most proud of. In January, the session was geared towards digital storytelling. And again, that came directly from the staff. I gave them a survey, I asked them what they wanted. They overwhelmingly chose digital storytelling, so that's what we decided to do. However, this time, I decided I didn't want to just offer one group of people, the majority, but I wanted to offer, I wanted to honor everybody. So the other two choices were Twitter as a professional learning network, and also QR codes in the classroom and how they could be used. And so we did 15 minutes of digital storytelling, followed by breakout sessions for the very first time. And I had teacher leaders from in the school. Dave Crofts ran a session on QR codes. Amanda Marsden helped me run the session on Twitter as a PLN. I ran the session, or kind of walked between the two sessions on digital storytelling, a continuation of it, as well as looking at the iPads, because people had said they had wanted more time to do that, to put into their planning for the weeks coming. That was rated with, I believe it's a 4.3 out of 5, when I released the survey to them the next time around. People loved it. And I can tell you one overarching theme was from people, we wish we had more time. And it was really nice to hear, because I'm a tech guy, I always wish we had more time to do that. And so to hear that from them at the same time was fantastic. 45 minutes wasn't enough time. Even breaking into those little mini sessions, it just wasn't enough time for us. I've already began to plan for the next tech half day PD. Survey will go out, just like it always does. We'll do our half day and the survey will go out again. That's just kind of the model that we're using. Just to throw in my little plug, kind of like you did there, our next tech night will be around digital portfolios. It's March 30th, and you're all more than welcome to come and attend. If you have a child that is in either second, third, or fourth grade, that night is concentrated for them on using digital portfolios to show off your digital knowledge and your digital work. So please come. It's called Google Galaxy, which is a name that the Pond Cove E-team actually came up with. So it was really cool. But anyways, there's my little plug. Thank you for your time. I just wanted to say PD, let me take that back. PD, well planned out PD with consistent and constant staff input is absolutely essential for our school. And one thing that I forgot that I left out here, one of our more technologically savvy members of our staff, Amy Kieran, actually said to me when I told her I was preparing to come in and talk to you guys tonight, she said, based on the PD sessions that we had this year, she realized that there are ways to use different things that she never ever thought of before. And she's one of the people that I would kind of put up there on the technological ladder, if there were one, of our building. And she said that the way to use this app, Book Creator, she never would have thought of it if we wouldn't have had that full school 45-minute PD for technology. So that's my two cents. I'll answer any questions or anything if you have any. Other than that, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. How are you? Thank you for being here tonight and having us all and listening to our opinions. So I'm here also to speak on behalf of the half-day professional early releases at Pond Cove. Over the past year, I've been doing a lot of reading of professional texts. And my focus on reading has really been about improving school cultures and instructional efficacy and improving student learning. And the thing that I keep coming across time and again is that the best way to achieve this, the most immediate way to achieve this, is really through establishing collaborative cultures. And as we all know in our busy lives, that time is can be a big obstacle to that. And I would say that for teachers, that time is probably the most precious resource and the thing that we all wish that we had more of. I don't think once in my 15-year teaching career I ever went home and said, oh, well, I got everything done. I mean, that just never happens. It's always there's always something more that I can do. So in elementary school, I think we especially face this on a day-to-day basis because we're teaching every subject, and in the past few years, all of us have faced, such as you know, such an enormous influx of new mandates and reforms. They're all, well, some of them are well-intentioned, some of them I don't know what, but a lot of them are really well-intentioned, and they're huge, and they take a lot of time. And we're all working really hard to implement these things to the best of our abilities, but we're all really working hard separately, and when we are together and we have time to work together as we do on these early professional release days, the work is just so much better and so much more, has such a higher impact in our classrooms and a more immediate impact in our classrooms. This year, on some of those days, like Mr. Schalter or Tom talked about, we've done a lot of work around technology integration. I am so proud of the work that we do at Pond Cove around with technology integration. I can tell you that kids don't have iPads or devices in their hands just to sit and get information. Kids have these devices in their hands, and they're creating things, and they're talking to each other about resources. They're learning how to be digital citizenships, which is just is very equal to just being a regular citizen. So we've had a lot of great conversations around that. Another part of these early release days has been time to connect with interventionists and special education teachers, time for them to meet together as teams, as me as the regular classroom teacher, to talk with them. That's so important. I can't tell you how important that is to making sure that every single student at Pond Cove has a completely rich and integrated experience, just like everybody. Also, we've had time to work on teasing out the many layers of the Common Core, which is also very big and really important. And I can tell you, just in the conversations that we have alone around the Common Core, my teaching and knowledge of what I'm teaching the kids is that much better and that much deeper. We've also had time to look at the STAR and talk about the STAR that Ruth Ellen was talking about, the STAR assessment. And like she said, there's no reason, we want assessments to be useful for our instruction. And in these early release days, we've had time to do that together. There are certain teachers who have just really become very knowledgeable about how to use the data and how to split apart the data and use it for grouping kids and making instructional decisions. And we've done some of that work on the early release days. And also just, it's given us an opportunity to sit together and look at student work and just reflect on what's going well and not going well in the classroom and how we can make things better. And finally, I'll just say, as a parent of a first grader at Pond Cove, my husband and I both work full time and then some, and I know it's really hard. These early release days can be a really big challenge at times, and we've made it work, but I have to say that I know that it is worth it because I know that it's improving the experience that he's getting at Pond Cove. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Debbie Butterworth. I'm the math support teacher at Pond Cove, and I run the Pond Cove Math Lab for students. And I'd like to share with you the enormous benefits the early release days built into our calendar for this year. Having blocks of time completely dedicated to teacher collaboration is a gift with no comparison. Whether our time is spent in a workshop format or learning about the Common Core, it's always time well spent and has allowed teachers time to collaborate, explore technology, share ideas, plan innovative teaching strategies, and learn new teaching methodologies. It's always an opportunity for our entire staff to get the same information at the same time, which doesn't happen too often because we can be so isolated in our own teams or our own hallways. The positive impact on student learning is almost without measure. For example, yesterday we had the unique opportunity to learn more about the importance of specific instruction and measured practice with computational fluency, something near and dear to my heart, delivered by an author and consultant to Everyday Math from Western Michigan University. Helping our students in all grades master fact fluency is really a core focus of our math instruction this year and helps our students meet several standards on the Common Core, in addition to building a stronger mathematical foundation. Following yesterday's presentation, teams met to further develop the work we're already doing with everyone's eyes on the same target, so to speak, because we'd all heard the presentation together. I wish you could have been there. It was just great. Thanks so much for giving us that opportunity.
Thank you.
My name's Rosemary Ginn, and I'm a literacy specialist at Pond Cove, and I'm not going to talk about how many years I've been doing this. It's way too many some days. As you have heard from my very esteemed colleagues, that the educators at Pond Cove are very committed to helping all students successfully meet the state's challenging new learning standards. Excuse me. A critical tool in achieving that success is providing teachers with collaborative, job-embedded professional learning opportunities that ultimately help to ensure the success of students. Teachers are also going to be held accountable for this kind of ongoing collaboration as one of the criteria in the new evaluation system. There is a strong body of research supporting this approach, and their 2009 report titled Professional Learning in the Learning Profession, the National Staff Development Council, summarizes research on professional learning for educators. A few of their key findings include intensive professional development boosts student achievement. Effective professional development is intensive, ongoing, connected to practice, and builds strong working relationships among teachers. Nations that outperform the United States on international assessments invest heavily in this type of professional learning. That, I think, is what is sort of expected to be heard here tonight, and I think a lot of you probably already know that and believe it. But one of the things I wanted to really comment on tonight, because I did leave education for almost 5 years and lived in a different world, so I would like to comment tonight on the relationship businesses have to collaboration, weekly meetings, retreats, and their own form of ongoing professional development so their employees reach their potential that then helps the business to grow and prosper. All I had to do was to Google any one of those topics, and there was more than enough information that shows how valuable having time to collaborate, set goals, listen, and learn from each other grows businesses, therefore they prosper. I have this one article from a site promoting e-marketing for business, and it says, you should always organize meetings that include everyone that is involved with the company. It is imperative to the infrastructure and growth of your business. Regardless of how many people are part of the business, getting together for meetings should be an organized routine that all companies implement. These meetings are going to be the driving force in building your business and developing newer and better ways to conduct business. Some businesses might prefer to do one-on-one meetings, which of course can be very effective because of the intimate setting, and comfort that comes with it. But what they lack is group dynamics. Just as we all learned at school when young, participating in group discussions and providing feedback not only makes the outcome of the discussion more successful, but everyone in the group has learned new things. There are a few different reasons why having these meetings will help your small business. First, it provides everyone with some structure. Second, it gives you a chance to hold everyone else accountable for their part of the team effort by setting goals and pushing each other to reach them. The other aspect of these meetings that will keep businesses going and heighten productivity is setting goals together and striving to hit those goals by the next meeting. Goals will vary for each business depending on how often meetings are, but the best idea is to set those goals for the next meeting so employees are holding each other accountable. They will always strive harder to meet goals if they feel part of a team effort and have motivation from others. The school board, you guys, you have a retreat, and I'm sure in your work lives you have opportunities to collaborate and meet with your other coworkers. I've always wondered at how hard it is for teachers to be given the same time when their job is to ensure the success of students, the future leaders of those businesses. In these times of challenging new initiatives, 21st century learning, global education, it is more imperative than ever that educators be given time to improve their skills so they can more effectively ensure student success. This is not a new model. When I worked in Raymond, Maine, now I am going to date myself, in the 1980s, we had early release every Wednesday, and it is currently used in many districts in Maine. I want to thank you for this opportunity, but also to ask you for your continued support of the release time at Pond Cove. Thank you.
Thank you, Mercy.
Wow. So I have for you two proposals that I think will provide you with a framework of the logistics and how we can successfully continue with early release days. And I have a handout that is a graphic for you. And you'll see one of the dates was an error, so I've written over it. As these are coming around, just to give you some background, I got input from our team leaders, our student support team, and the superintendent and director of instruction on what they thought, what ways we could make this work. And so I'll go through the proposals and field any questions that you have. As you can see, proposal one has Pond Cove at an early release Monday time, dismissal time at 1:30 p.m., and the professional development time would be from 1:45 to 4:30 p.m. And it's important to note, too, that these two proposals are embedded in the professional Mondays, so that would extend our time to 4:30. Also, if you leap to the bottom, it says transportation, and speaking with Meredith, it was actually her good thinking on providing a bus for students at 3 p.m. So the impact to families would, in terms of the time, would not be, there wouldn't be an impact to their scheduling that they're normally used to for a regular school day. So going back to the first proposal, we would have 2 hours and 45 minutes of professional development time that would be sustained time. And we're looking, because that would be shorter than our current time, dismissal time of 12 noon, we are proposing to have 7 days. And we looked really closely at the calendar and took into consideration some feedback from the board last time of not having breaking up weeks that already had an impact or bumping up. So you can see, and for the benefit of the public, I'll say what dates they are. It's September 19th. October 31st, we know what that is, December 5th, January 30th, March 6th, April 3rd, and May 8th. And we've parsed them out so that there would also be a continuity for professional learning throughout the school year. And I think what's most important for families is, for many families, is the childcare options. And again, going back to the collaboration of my colleague Jeff Shedd, having Cape Elizabeth High School students have extended learning opportunities come up to the school, so it would be on-site to run crafts, games, outdoor activities. These would be supervised by Pond Cove Ed Techs, who already are paid to be there anyway. The number of Ed Techs needed would be dependent upon the number of students whose families sign them up in advance of each date. And this would be offered from the dismissal time of 1:30 to 3 p.m. And that's when then there would be a late bus available for them to come to be picked up and brought home or brought to their destination where they would normally go. The other offering would still be community services offerings for those families that are interested in that. And proposal number two, we have the same childcare options and the same transportation option. Proposal number two would be what we have right now, and that would be a 12 o'clock noon dismissal. So that's 3 hours and 45 minutes. But instead of 7 early release days, we would have, we would, we're proposing it would be the same five, and that those dates would be, for the benefit of the public, September 19th, December 5th, January 30th, March 6th, and May 8th. And also taking into consideration, we have the K-12 professional days also embedded into the calendar, so we worked around those as well. So that is what we have come up with in terms of what we think can best accommodate families and be sensitive to their schedules, also keep the children obviously purposely engaged, while at the same time really allowing us to really continue with the really good work that we've had, you know, thanks to you providing us with these great opportunities that we've had this year. They've just been, I think my colleagues spoke really well on the benefits that we've had this year, and we still have one more to go, but happy to answer. I'm sure you have questions, and happy to answer anything.
I'll be happy to start off. All else being equal, is an additional hour, 3 hours and 45 minutes with less occurrences, 5 versus 2 hours and 45 minutes, in terms of the effectiveness, is the extra hour critical, just so we can,
there's two choices,
there's two proposals, but teacher feedback, what would be their?
And their feedback was, if we had two additional days, they felt that would be beneficial, versus if we went to a later, because I know last month at the board meeting that was also proposed as a question, but they felt that would be beneficial if we had 7 early release days, so more days, later dismissal time, versus the current time that we have with just the 5 days.
So I know we've been over this before, and I apologize because I have a terrible memory about this stuff. So there's 5 K-12 full days that are already used up for other professional development purposes in the district. Is that right?
Those are the typically driven by the district to decide, typically more district driven versus building based. Sometimes it really kind of depends.
Is there an opportunity to use parts of those days for building days?
If we're given that option, it kind of depends on what they intend, what the intended use is.
And then there's also the regular 3 K-12 early release days as well.
Right.
Are those also professional development days?
Well, like the last one we had just before February vacation, that was a K-12 day where we went to the high school, all K-12 staff went to the high school, so we had professional development all together. So it was more, it was not building based, yeah. So
I imagine those opportunities are rare.
Right.
And then, so on top of those two teacher-only professional development opportunity days, you're asking for an additional 5 for Pronto building.
We are, a big piece of that is because of the parity, because our middle school and high school colleagues have more planning time, a lot more planning time than elementary. And so
within the normal course of their day.
Right. So there isn't, and in terms of working all together, there's less team time within teams, and then there's that real important cross grade level work that we feel is really essential. And because the elementary also teaches all the disciplines, there's the cross disciplinary work that we find to be really beneficial as well.
How come Mondays, not Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday?
Well, Mondays have always, that's what has been in the calendar. There really isn't, we certainly can entertain another day of the week because there was some feedback that Mondays and Fridays were not
as best, but Mondays have been, they've been, like, the district calls them professional Mondays. So it's been that way for a long time, but it can be, many districts have Wednesdays, at, you know, midweek. So it really, there's really nothing magical about Monday other than it backs up to what we consider the professional Monday, which goes till 4:30, but we could make Wednesday, professional Wednesday. So it doesn't have to be a Monday.
I appreciate the consideration of going with a slightly later release. I think that it accomplishes a couple of things. It doesn't impact your instructional day as much, for one thing. And second of all, with high school volunteers coming down, an hour and a half is a lot different than three. Mm-hmm. In terms of supervising children, keeping them engaged, feeling energized still at the end of that period of time. And so noting the dates that you looked at, it appears to give you a good flow of being able to reconvene in ways that keep momentum going. I know if there's too much of a break in PD, trying to get back and reconstruct where you left off can be tricky. So I applaud you.
Meredith and Ruth Ellen were really helpful with that when we looked at what the best dates would be, mm-hmm. As far as so things weren't bumping up or conflicting with all the other various dates that we have throughout the calendar.
Heather? Yeah, I have a few questions. One is following up on Susanna about Mondays and just entertaining the ideas. For example, if somebody works, both parents work and one of the parents is only working Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays, that means for either 5 or 7 Mondays, they have to find alternative care, as opposed to if it was scattered, maybe those part-time parents that are free on Tuesday and Thursdays, and it jumped around the week a little bit, they would have a little bit more support and say, oh, okay, it's only 2 days that I have to get the support because two of the other days are on a Thursday or Tuesday when I don't work. I don't know if that's a feasible idea, if the consistency on having it one day is important, but it's just a thought to consider that those who don't work.
And I hear that. I think, and I understand what you're saying, because if people did have a work schedule, that there was always that conflict. I think one of the challenges in terms of having the continuity of one set day, no matter what it is, because we also have district committee meetings, and some, you know, like Mondays, we usually avoid Mondays for having committee meetings when we know, other than the 7:30 a.m. policy committee meetings. But I think we would just have to be mindful, you know, of the district-wide how we would schedule committee meetings and
yeah. Okay, and I had two more questions. One is that this childcare option with the high school students, aren't the students supposed to be in class? How are they leaving class to come down and do this? Or are they out of class? I don't have a high school student yet, so I'm sorry if this
well,
is
when
an
I,
obvious question.
When
are they out
Jeff,
of school already?
Jeff and I talked about this. You know, we would flesh out a plan about it. It's more from the high school base, but we looked at it as they would be extended learning opportunities or service learning. I think the intention too is not, they wouldn't be the same students for every single early release day. So whether it was a rotating schedule. So the intent wasn't to pull them out, but it was really to enhance their experience as well.
I would love to hear a little more about that, because, yes.
So the proposal that has the later early release, in other words, 1:30 versus noon,
yes.
that would be relatively straightforward to deal with, because it lines up quite nicely, not perfectly, but quite nicely with our last period of the day, which is a rotating period. And so it would be fairly straightforward out of the fairly large pool of students we have to find students who already do not have a class scheduled that last period, who have a study hall or something like that. It would become a little more challenging, not impossible, but I would say more challenging, definitely, with the noon early release. But, so.
Thank you. And then I had, just have one more question, and I think this is more directed to the teachers, just out of curiosity. I fully believe in the professional development and think it's wonderful, and I'd like to support it. I also think the instructional time in the kids, for the children in the classroom, and when you look at the schedule and see how much non-classroom time they are, and I don't suggest that I have the answers because there's a balance, but can you speak to that? I mean, it's more time pulling the kids away from having their teachers there to teach them. It's less classroom time for them. And I'm just curious about your thoughts on that. I don't know if one of you would be willing to stand up again and speak. I'd just love to hear you speak to that. Because that's my biggest concern, is the students learning.
I mean, I think that's a great question. I think that the overall, yes, the teachers don't like interrupted time. I mean, we like to have weeks and weeks with right. the kids all at once. I think the time, about the thing that I spoke about before was the time for planning, the time for looking at the assessment data and looking at just their work in general is what, when we're able to do that, then we can turn around in the classroom and use that so much more effectively and make our instruction so much better. So I do think that the benefits outweigh from a teacher's perspective, I feel like the benefits of having that time outweigh the loss of the few hours of classroom instruction time. I also think that without that time to do the work that I was talking about before, we're squeezing it in. And as someone who has constantly been trying to squeeze into things, I can tell you that that is not the most efficient and effective way of reaching kids and making sure that I'm giving the most engaging lessons and having the most engaging experience for them. So.
Can I ask you one more question?
Yeah, sure.
Are you using, I think I heard this, that some of these professional development times are also times to talk about individual children and help see every child and work collaboratively to help every child feel success?
That's the overall goal. And if there is there have been times when there have been particular students or maybe a particular student profile that a team that directly works with that child or that student profile has been able to come together and then just really coordinate schedules and talk about what the goals are currently set as and how we might need to readjust those goals. So that's some of the work that's happened. We've also had some work with a consultant around behavior, and that's been really helpful just so that there is a school-wide vision for behavior intervention and social-emotional intervention. So that's some of the work that's happened to address individual student needs. But ultimately, the goal is to make sure that we use that time as efficiently as possible so that we are able to work together, especially if there's a kiddo that needs us to work together.
Thanks,
Heather.
I mean, here's my thoughts on it. One is that, our concern was that it's going to impact instructional time. The proposal one would have the least impact on instructional time by starting it at 1:45 versus 12:45. If you take an hour and a half times 7 professional days, and I am a numbers person, it would be about a 0.8% reduction in instructional time based on feedback from our educators. I'm more than confident that you're getting more than 1% enhancement in instructional and culture. So I think it's a extremely high return on the time. And another concern we had was, you know, parents who couldn't afford childcare. Should we do it on, or schedule child care options? Should we do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday? It doesn't matter because childcare options either have option one or two. It's a parental choice. So if they choose not to take advantage of it, we've done our best to give opportunities. In terms of the impact on the high school students, I think it would be an hour. I do have a residual concern. It says ed techs are needed. There will be ed techs needed, but they also have professional development needs. So whatever reduction this would have in ed tech professional development, we need to find it somewhere else. So I don't want us to look at, you know, teachers, and they may benefit from the professional development as well. So that one we may have to adjust. But I strongly support proposal one. It's what the choice of what the teachers, it's the limited, limits the impact on instructional time. It provides childcare options for parents. So, you know, I would welcome other school board member thoughts, but we asked for it. My bottom line is we can't expect the great things to happen at the schools without professional development. It's a line item in the strategic plan that we should hold up just as much as self-directed learning. You know, so these great things in the strategic plan, for them to happen, teachers need time to meet. So I'll only support proposal one or proposal two. Anything that eliminates professional development, I think, is a huge mistake, and I strongly support proposal one.
So I'll just interject and say that we're not voting tonight, that this is just a on the communications. But going, just wanted to remind people about that. Go ahead, John.
No, I was just going to echo those comments. I pretty much agree with everything you said. Oh, and I really appreciate the work to come back with this creative set of proposals. I think you did a really fine job of balancing the concerns and marshaling the resources to minimize impact. I appreciate it.
Well, it was a collaborative effort. So thank you.
I do really love the creativity that has gone into trying to minimize the impact on all involved. And I really love the idea of using the last period of the day to sort of scope out some kids who wouldn't otherwise have a class, because that was a major red flag for me, because classroom time for everybody, including high school students, is important. So, interesting.
I just would like to, first of all, thank the teachers for coming in here and sharing with us what you're doing every day during these professional days. It was not a concern that they weren't being used well, but it's really nice to hear what's going on, and I think it helps the parents and the public understand not just that we say it's in the strategic plan and it's important, but now, though you've helped educate the board, you've helped educate the public what is going on during those days. So that's really important, and I thank you for that. I thank you also for bringing these creative proposals, and I hear that nice balance in that 1:30 dismissal. Again, we're not voting tonight, but I hear what the teachers are saying, and I hear what my fellow board members are saying. So tonight, what I'll just reiterate, we're voting on the calendar, like overall, the parameters of the calendar, like when we're starting and when we're ending. We're not actually, because, you know, we're just getting this information tonight. So hopefully at a future meeting, we'll be able to settle this. And we really appreciate you doing this extra work.
Well, thank you. It actually helped us to be reflective and to refine it and to make it better, so that we can maximize the time, but also obviously be very sensitive to family needs and our, most importantly, our student needs. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. I'm going to carefully look at my agenda so I don't skip around anymore. I'm up. So item 5D, it says school board interview committee, and what I would like to do is just actually touch a little bit more upon the memo that was included in the agenda packet talking about superintendent search activities that have been conducted, upcoming work, and that sort of thing. I'm not going to read everything, but we advertise very broadly, online and in print media, nationally and statewide. There is a website,
supersearch.cape.k12.me.us that is accessible through the school department website at the top. There's a superintendent search link at the top. Hopefully that is being utilized not only by prospective applicants, but also the public to kind of get an understanding of what we're doing. There's a news item on the side that people can stay updated. There's been pretty broad stakeholder engagement conducted primarily by Connie Brown, our consultant from MSMA. And so lots of opportunity for input from multiple areas. And at this time, there is an ongoing community input survey, which is accessible through the school district and town website for community members, parents, and students. So for the March activities, tonight we will be appointing the advisory screening committee. The process around that was that each building was asked, as far as teachers, each building was asked to nominate amongst the teachers were asked to nominate who they felt would best represent them, who they would trust to be on that committee. And we received names from all building principals. The district leadership team met and decided amongst themselves who they would like to represent them on that. And then we received applications from community members and parents talking about why they would like to be a part of this work and what they would bring to the work. And so that's sort of how the committee was formed. Quickly moving forward, I want to clear up, there's a little bit of talk early on about, you know, a hiring committee, and so what we are going forward with is an interview committee. So after the screening committee work is done, which will screen, rank, and make recommendations, that's the end of that work, that's the end of that committee. Then we have an interview committee. And what I'm proposing for the interview committee is the entire board, all seven members, one or two administrators. I actually am leaning towards two, and I never fixed that in my memo. And three teachers, one from each building, to be a part of the first round interviews, which are called the semi-finalist interviews, which is strange to me, but that's what it's called. So it means more work back to the buildings, and I apologize for that, but the board will talk about that. However, you know, it's again reaching out and asking teachers to be a part of that first round. I'd like to clarify a little bit. There had been some confusion around how the interviews were conducted the last time we hired a superintendent. And so I went back to agendas and committee appointments and tried to just sort it out for my own. And so there were no teachers involved in the interviews, the actual interviews, the last time we hired a superintendent. But just because that's the way it was done last time doesn't mean that's the way we need to do it this time. So I am recommending that we do involve teachers on the first round of interviews. The second and final rounds would be just the board. I've already touched on the online survey. Applications closed today. The advisory screening committee training is tomorrow. The advisory screening committee will review and rank and make recommendations on March 14th. And then we move quickly into, you know, needing an interview committee, because that interview committee is going to have a training date of March 17th, because I don't think there's going to be any more snow, Meredith. I just don't. However,
thank you.
I'm just
delighted to hear that.
That is a snow date on our budget calendar. However, we felt pretty strongly that if that date needed to be used, March 17th, that we could move the training date, the training time to 5:30. It should be a pretty short.
Would that be prior to our finance?
Prior to the finance committee. So you can write in
March 17th. First round interviews, we're looking at the weeks of March 21 and 28. And these, you know, as we start working with applicants and, you know, where they're coming from in their schedules, that's going to kind of inform how we're able to get this done. And we're getting a little bit further out now, and so I just want to remind people that this is a time frame, but things do change a little bit. So as we move into April, you can see that we're looking at having second round interviews held during the week of April 11th. That's the week that leads up to April vacation. So again, everybody be prepared for flexibility and changes and that sort of thing. So I'm not going to go hugely too far into the future. I'd love to have some, we're not voting on the establishment of the interview committee tonight, but I'd love to hear if board members support my just sort of straw vote, and we will actually probably need a special business meeting to appoint that interview committee before, so we'll probably be at the March 15th. I'm trying to think. Budget hearing. We might need a short, like a 3-minute special business meeting to actually appoint. But at this point, do people feel comfortable with that committee, the core of all seven board members, three teachers, one from each, or three staff? I would rather say staff, actually, and two administrators.
I'm not really weighing in there's a capacity in this process, except that I will say that I have seen a lot of districts have students involved sometimes in that interview process, and it's a good opportunity, I think, for student representation and student voice in a process. Just putting that up.
Elizabeth?
Mm-hmm.
That's why I said it. So what I'm wondering is whether or not, like, in terms of the next step, the interviewing committee, do we want new members, not school board, but new members from, you know, administration and teachers, a brand new slate or not? I'm just wondering how
right.
we weigh that out.
So the way I'm framing this is that the advisory screening committee is its own committee. People nominated themselves and voted with that understanding. There was no understanding that those people would be moving on to an interview committee. So I don't think that would be fair to say that that's locked in. I think that we communicated that the advisory screening committee's work would be done after they ranked and made recommendations, and then that committee would be dissolved. So I recommend, it could be the same if that's how the votes work out, and that. But I don't think we should say, okay, that's the group we're using. I strongly suggest that we, I understand it's an imposition, but I feel really strongly that we go back out to the buildings and back out to the DIT and ask the administrators to work on those two people that they would like to represent them on an interview team, and I would love to reach back out to the teachers because it's different work. It's a different task. So I hope that feel clear to everybody. Joe?
We might want to think a little bit about how to make sure we involve special education, because we're sort of in flux at this point, and I think I'm not sure exactly what the logistics of getting put on that, but I think it will be important to have that part of the process, mm-hmm. and particularly in this transition time. Mm-hmm.
That's a good point.
Does anybody have any thoughts about possibly reaching out and adding a couple, a student or two, likely from the high school, to be a part of the interview committee?
We could only add.
Yeah, I feel great about having seven school board members, two administrators, and the administrators decide, you know, we'll do one, maybe, how about one student and three teachers, and And I think all school board members, administrators, teachers work with all of our students. So if the administrators happen to select, you know, well, I guess it'd be hard to, the special ed interim director, that's up to their prerogative, so.
Or one of the three teachers could be a special educator, too. That's possible.
That would be a way of getting in. Because I'm looking at the numbers, that would make in a 13-person interview.
We're starting to get big.
It gets cumbersome.
Yeah.
And intimidating. I think ensuring one of the teachers be a special ed teacher is an excellent way to ensure that we're broadening as much representative of our district as possible.
I think that those folks will have a different concern and perspective.
Yes. I'm wondering.
Yeah, I agree. I'm just curious. I'm not sure how we can, do we say, okay, high school, you have to do that, make that, or I don't know how that logistically would play out.
Maybe what we could think of is, in order to really balance it out, we've got two administrators and three teachers, one from each building. Maybe one of the, never mind. That's not working.
I know the logistics are difficult, but I do think it is I just wanted to, yeah.
I mean, it's adding one more person, and if how about if one doesn't naturally come forward in the voting process, we can just add one, an additional person representing special ed, if it doesn't come forth on its own through the teachers and the administrators.
Do we want to make sure that one of the teachers who is a special ed teacher is from a building that doesn't have an administrator? That's getting kind of complicated, but I'm trying to spread the love.
We're not voting on this tonight.
We're not.
I think you have enough.
This is a thinking, but we will be voting on it next Tuesday.
Yes.
Just,
things
are moving. Things are going along pretty quickly.
It's important deliberation, and unfortunately, it gets messy, but.
I'd love to hear your input, Merit.
No, I was just going to suggest if you're voting next Tuesday, people in buildings are going to need to
turn around
and get working on these decisions immediately. So I would suggest that either the board give you some consent to move forward, for you to work out the logistics and move this process forward, or a small board that's been working on some of these logistics, or that you make a decision now.
Yeah, we need to get the word out to the building.
All right, I have a suggestion thinking about, because we've talked about this.
Bless you again.
Thank you.
13 or 14 is gonna be a big committee if we add a student. So what if we stay with your recommendation, add one student, and add one K-12 special educator who's elected by their peers. So we have a student rep, and because of the transition and not having a new director who can join us, that there be a teacher that peers ask to represent them at the table.
So a fourth teacher?
Yes.
Okay.
So fourth.
I just want to be clear.
Yes. Or faculty, or, you know, special ed staff. It could be a psychologist.
Yep. Yep. Yep.
But whoever's the special ed staff might choose to represent them in lieu of having a director at the table.
Mm-hmm.
So go to 14. I mean, it's a party anyway.
Exactly.
Yep.
I think voice is important on this.
Mm-hmm. I do too.
Maybe if you summarize, Elizabeth, what the
proposal
is, even.
I'm going to try to summarize what the new proposal is. And so, establishment of an interview committee to include all seven board members, two administrators, one teacher from each building, one student, and one special ed staff member that works K-12. Is
for a total of 14.
Or represents K-12.
Represents
they necessarily
K-12.
Need to work K-12.
Agreed. Represents K-12. Yeah. I think that's a nice.
Mm-hmm.
a nice way to work it out, because I felt really uncomfortable saying, hey, middle school, you can only pick a special ed person. And then, well, maybe that wasn't. So I like that. Do we have a consensus?
Yep.
It's a question.
All right, we'd be asking the high school student government to nominate their student.
Yep, we'd like to do that.
So, looking up and down the board, I'll take nods since we're not really voting.
Yeah.
Okay. So I will reach out to the DLP, building principals, and the student government, either through Mr. Shedd, I think that's probably the most appropriate way for me to do that, and ask for people to have their representation back to me. I'm going to say we by Monday, because we need to nominate, we need to do that committee Tuesday night. So that's, I'm saying it right now, I'm going to go home and write the email. People feel comfortable with that. Great. Thank you, everybody.
So,
I know.
Wait, I'm going to back you up on that. So tonight's discussion was to discuss the final composition, but the actual formation, they don't need to meet for the first time until March 17th.
Right.
Do we want to vote on the actual people who are taking those seats at our March 15th meeting?
Yeah.
And that way it gives a little extra time?
That's the plan.
Is that Monday?
Yes, that's next week.
That's the plan.
I was trying to buy you some time.
Nope. No lost week in there, Joe.
Wow.
That's the plan.
It's all happening way too fast. Okay.
Next week is March 15th. Our
I'm going to go.
Budget workshop. We're going to add a brief special business meeting, hopefully to elect members to that committee. That committee will then have a training and interview question generation meeting on St. Patrick's Day.
Perfect.
So that,
17th.
In the nominations, these people need to be available for those particular
Right, events. Which is why I have said that's one of the first. And it is hopefully the this memo should be available, and although the date says TBA, so I will make sure and reiterate that the first training session is on March 17th. So I don't want to hold things up any longer. If people have further questions about process, feel free to contact me. And the end of the packet is just our various advertising that we use. And I would like to highlight that the last advertisement was created by our own vice chair. Looked great, really beautiful. Great. Thank you.
Thank you for that hard work, Elizabeth.
Moving on to item 5E, superintendent's report.
Okay, it's already after 9. I'm doing this in 2 minutes. Board should have received the NEAS schedule reminder for next week. So if you have any questions about that, you can forward them to me or Jeff or Elizabeth. You've already heard about the VEX Robotics Championship, so I won't belabor that. We have a middle school student, Caden Lee, who will be competing in the state Geography Bee. So congratulations to him on April 1st. We wish him well. It is Youth Art Month, and fourth grader Eliza Green's cut paper design is currently being exhibited at the Portland Museum of Art until April 3rd, and there was a little celebration for those artists this past Saturday. World Affairs Council Trivia Night is being held on April 3rd, and Susanna may be in contact with some of you because there's a long board tradition of participation in that event. There are a number of upcoming events on the school calendar, so I won't belabor all of those at this point.
Thank you. Moving on to new business. Item 6A, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the proposed 2016-2017 academic year calendar.
Do we want to amend the motion to have it say for the beginning and end dates, still to discuss half dates?
Or do we need to clarify?
We can. We don't have a motion yet to amend, so if
someone
we get
needs
a second,
a
then we can.
Yeah, I'll second. Thank you.
Okay.
Do we need a clarification?
So that's the question. Do we need a clarification? Because the calendar before us doesn't have the 7 days. That's
So we can either approve this and amend, or we can approve only the pieces which are firm. You have a choice.
Yes. So I amend the proposal.
So before you go there, can I just reiterate the broad picture as a reminder, because it's been several months since this original draft came forward, and we've gone back and forth around the early release dates in particular. But the broad calendar construct, as a reminder, we have to align our calendar with six other districts who send students to PAS. And before me, I have the Falmouth, South Portland, Portland, Yarmouth, Cumberland, and Gray New Gloucester calendars. We cannot have more than 5 days across those seven districts that don't align. As of right now, we have our conference day scheduled for October 21st, a November 10th workshop day in Falmouth, a January 20th workshop day in Gray New Gloucester, which is why we also have a workshop day that day, a February 17th workshop day in Cumberland, and the fact that Cumberland and one other district start school before Labor Day. So we're done. That's it. Those are the 5 days. One challenge that we face locally that these other districts don't face next year is that Election Day is November 8th. And Election Day for us is held at the high school. And I know there are grave concerns on the part of the assistant town manager about the fact that we will be holding the presidential election on that day and still have school in session. The only real alternative for us on that day would be to move our conferences, which are traditionally held in late October, to early November. That presents some other challenges, obviously, because it is delaying those early conversations with parents about and teachers about children. So we have discussed some creative solutions, which could mean asking students to park off-site and sending buses to shuttle students to the school campus.
I was going to ask what the concerns really are. Are they around
parking? Largely around parking. You know, particularly that back lot is somewhat limited in size, and so for people who might need accessible parking, that's a challenge. But there are ways to shuttle perhaps even poll workers from this site or another off-site location as well. So we think we can work logistically around those hurdles. There certainly are advantages to having students in school on an election day from a civics perspective, so we think we can overcome that. But that is why our calendar exists in those broad parameters as it does. We have two early release days that are district-wide built into the calendar as well, and those days fall right before the February vacation on February 17th, and right before the April vacation on April 13th. This year we're using those days to focus on assessment literacy as related to our piloting, which will continue to be piloted next year, evaluation system. But those are some additional PD time based on, I think, your point earlier, Michael, that there are a lot of initiatives and work related to the strategic plan that this district has been trying to accomplish. And when we can find time that has limited impact on student learning, we try to do that. Those 2 days before the breaks have historically been somewhat low attendance days. So we've tried to capitalize on that as professional development time. So those, I think, are the broad pieces that you would be voting on. They include a 3-day break at Thanksgiving, which is traditional for us, a break between December 23rd and January 2nd, a week-long vacation in February, and a week-long vacation in April. The start of school September 6th, and projected end date, depending on snow, would be June 15th.
I think the board just wants to be clear that if we're adopting the calendar as presented, that we aren't adopting the K-4 early release yet. We just, you know.
That is correct.
And I want
you
that to
be. You could choose to do that. We had discussed it the prior meeting, just due to the limited amount of time for you to be able to consider that, just adopting the calendar without that information and adding that in later. Those release days do not impact the PATH's calendar alignment.
Great.
As long as when this calendar is posted as approved, there's a big asterisk saying five, you know, early release days will be added as soon as there's a vote. Great.
Just out of, you know...
If those five are already on here, we would be actually adding the seventh.
We haven't decided yet.
Yeah, well, I know, we haven't...
Well, actually, the ninth isn't on there.
The five and the seven overlap, so the five are on here, it's just a question of whether you add...
So right now, they're only on as professional Mondays, because those are for after-school hours, but you're correct that we had talked about aligning the release days with those professional Mondays.
The numbering in the month of August, September seems...
Wacky?
Wacky.
The numbering with respect to...
So it goes from September 1st to the 16th, and then it starts at the 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th.
Yeah,
is there an extra week, maybe?
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Two birthdays.
And oh, yeah.
Excellent.
Yes, I think you can just...
And 219.
Perfect, we're going to 2 weeks in September. Congratulations, we found extra PD time. Okay, so you can strike the repeat week that starts with a Monday the 15th, because there isn't one.
That probably doesn't exist.
Thank you for catching that.
Eagle eye.
Read right by it.
I was wondering why that looked so long, but you know.
Right.
Yeah, there's one.
September, I wouldn't mind.
I know it feels like a long month.
Another month, you know, September's nice.
Don't age twice.
Thank you, Joe.
Exactly.
So.
Well, that's fun.
Let's, yeah.
Just to clarify, I think we've spent three meetings on the early release professional development days, and are we proposals to approve a calendar but not make a decision on the early release days? Just to clarify, I'm not sure.
That's what is on the agenda at this time.
So what additional information are we seeking to make a vote on?
Quite sure we're looking for additional information, but perhaps deliberation time and feedback from the public who are also hearing this for the first time. It's sort of, I feel that we've got a tradition of, if we have new information that's put before us, there's at least a period of comment time. I agree with you that this does seem like a long time, and my first knee-jerk reaction was, why don't we just pick one of the options and put it on the calendar, but I'm feeling respectful of due process.
And also to that point, because of the parents who have, you know, said Mondays and Fridays are probably the hardest days, you know, to take off. Like, it just to give us a little extra time for feedback in whether or not, you know, Mondays and Fridays, or Mondays in general.
But the proposals before us, you don't have to take off. Your decision, if you choose to, it's your decision as a parent. There are childcare options, community services, and a new offering where Cape Elizabeth High School students would run crafts. Your child wouldn't have to, would get home at the same time as they would if it was an early release day. Is that correct?
My understanding.
So, you know, it's up to the parent. So, I understand it, but we've surveyed, now I think surveys are instructional, but they're not definitive. It's not, oh, here's our survey from the parents, we're going to vote this way, or, you know, we've asked for feedback. So, would we just approve this and then the next regular business meeting?
Mm-hmm, that's the plan.
Okay, and if we get feedback at that meeting that's new, then I mean, at what point do we say we've heard enough?
So not weighing in on the conversation, I'll just remind the board that the conversation at the last meeting was you wanted some additional information for us to come to you with some proposals. We discussed adopting a calendar with the broad parameters so that you would have time to consider those proposals and make a decision on the early release at a later meeting. So that's the process that we've articulated. The board certainly has the prerogative to change its mind.
We can wait another month, but I would be reluctant to release a schedule or to approve one that may change, because once parents get the calendar, you know, I think we can do this. I think, you know, the feedback is, you know, we want to limit instructional support time. Proposal one does that. childcare options, there's options. That doesn't mean we can dictate what parents decide is best for their children, but those are provided. We asked for teacher input. We had four teachers share, so.
I can just share that most of the comments I've gotten around calendar have been, well, we need to plan vacations. People are wanting to plan their family vacations. People are wanting to plan, you know, end of school year, beginning of school year. That's been two people. So when I say, that's it. Around the calendar as a whole. So it felt important that we take care of what we can take care of. And just with respect, I would like to kind of move forward with the agenda and the process that we had set forth, simply because this is the first time that all of us, including the public, have heard it. And while I think most of us probably have an idea what makes most sense to us, I want to be respectful of the process. So that's where I'm weighing in. And I feel great discomfort about releasing this with it having these purple, you know, that does worry me too. I do feel worried about that. So, you know, there's got to be a great big way to communicate that.
And a panko draft. Just
some way to communicate that we, everything is set in stone except for panko, which needs to be voted on next week. We need to put this to bed. Next week, next month.
Can I suggest we release the calendar of the draft then with the 7 days actually in there, and so that we're actually just affirming, if that's what we end up doing, affirming what we're doing, and there's actually no change to what's printed, if that's what we end up, in other words, go with what's most likely now, even if part of it is tentative. And then we can affirm the tentative piece.
Mm-hmm. That's a good idea.
I think that if we get the nods, it's like a straw vote. If we feel like that is the most likely option, then I agree that that's the way it should be released.
Makes sense.
Thank you.
So we fix the August, September, and put in the additional dates, and we can approve whatever portion tonight and affirm the other piece next.
No one's planning their vacation around Ponko Path Days. At least
not yet.
No, but.
Ways that we have that update.
Right. I think that's...
And to Michael's point, not having people see a calendar and then seeing another one and being confused.
Right, and it's clarifying. Mm-hmm. It is.
So is there a reason, I'm mindful of the time, and we're in 6A, that do we have to approve a calendar tonight? Is there any... Do other districts need for us to do that? Is there a... So let's... You know, it's going to be adjusted. The early release times are going to be different if we do proposal one, but we can't adjust it because we're not voting on it. So it's circular.
Should we table it?
We can't update the calendar because, well, we're not voting on it. So how do you know which one to put in there?
But Michael, in terms of first day of school and last day of school, if we can just nail that down, I'm sure there's a lot of families that would appreciate knowing that. Now rather than a month from now, knowing that that's not going to change.
And the vacation weeks.
And the vacation weeks.
And vacation weeks.
So either way, I think we can confirm that those are not changing. They haven't changed throughout this process. So again, whatever you wish to do.
So at this time, I think I'd like to call for a vote. Unless someone is moving, wants to table the motion, I think that's where we got to move on. So, all those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
And item 6B, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the School Board Advisory Screening Committee. Their charge, the Advisory Screening Committee will participate in training, then read and rank superintendent candidate applications. Upon completion of the ranking process, the advisory screening committee will forward its recommendations to the board's interview committee.
I second. And is there any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6C, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the slate of nominees, the School Board Advisory Screening Committee, to include School Board Representatives Michael Moore, Elizabeth Seifries, Barbara Powers, School Administrators Mike Tracy, Greg Marles, Teachers Sarah Harrington, Stephen Price, Rosemary Ginn, Parents Amy Stanley, Kimberly Carr, and Community Members Jim Clark and Carolyn Smith.
Second.
Any discussion? I would like to thank everybody that has offered to serve on this committee for their time, and we appreciate everybody's help with this really important task. So, thank you. All those in favor? Moving on to item 6D, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve an unpaid leave of absence for high school teacher Lauren Tarantino during the 2015-2016 school year.
I second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Moving on, we do not need a motion because these policies are for first read, but maybe Barbara, you could speak to those. Thank you.
As soon as I can find them. Okay, first read means these are our draft presentations to you, and for those listening, we won't vote on these until next month. But the first two are in section D of policy, which is around fiscal management. We reviewed DF, fundraising, and DFR, which is fundraising administrative procedure. And those are available for review online. Thanks to our administrators who were able to attend, and Meredith as well, we simply updated these to match current practice in terms of how fundraising occurs, who approves fundraising efforts, coordinating organizations to meet to kind of talk about equity and recognition issues, especially around Title IX and our athletic boosters. And so that's sort of the overall fundraising umbrella. Into the procedures that support it, DFR, there was a discussion about the fact that this codifies pretty well what we're talking about in terms of the kinds of approvals that are required. Individual fundraising that has a targeted amount over $20,000, for example, must have prior approval of the board. We're not touching that. It basically, I understand, primarily impacts project graduation efforts, so that will stand as is. Continued feeling strongly about projects resulting in alterations or additions to the physical plan or grounds must have prior written approval of the superintendent. And I would say that that's the one area. This procedure particularly excludes the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation, as it is a very independent functioning operation. We have not examined that closely, but that is one particular area that we may want to consider still having a formal protocol involved. But we'll talk about that at the next meeting because of the terrific efforts from that organization and the board's fiscal and property management responsibilities to the town. The fundraising administrative procedures continue on with student and school-based fundraising, and I think it's pretty straightforward. Again, no change truly in any of the protocols other than some small tweaks to the amount of times we meet, etc. Removing areas that are no longer true in terms of the kinds of funds, particularly that our athletic booster groups are able to furnish to assist with the cost of our sports program. DFF and student activity funds, the only issue we were made aware of there by our business manager is the third paragraph that talks about the senior classes as they graduate. We're going to ask that they take their class treasuries and transfer them to external accounts established by class representatives to use for reunions and so forth. Because right now, we apparently have accounts going back to the 80s that remain unclaimed. So we want our business manager rightfully suggested that we really make sure our seniors, as they leave us, move that money into accounts that their officers will then manage going forward. That was the only change we contemplated to that one. Any questions on those? Okay. Then moving on, there's been an athletic booster organization policy that kind of goes into a lot of protocols under the auspices of the athletic director that's been under fiscal management DFAB. It suggested it move to the athletics section of the book. We didn't spend a lot of time talking about this. More time was spent on a new booster organization proposed language that comes from MSMA that's found to be really helpful to districts trying to better manage relations with boosters. This is all around school community relations now. All those organizations who do amazing work helping support athletics and co-curriculars, particularly music, I understand at this point, but others may arise over time as the need happens. So Jeff Thorek was unable to be at our last meeting. We have this language that came straight from MSMA. According to Jeff Shedd and his best knowledge, this again reflects how business is done with our booster organizations now, but it will formalize it so that anyone supervising those efforts has policy to fall back on should questions arise. So again, nothing out of the ordinary here in terms of how we actually work, but I would suggest that all the board members have a chance to read through this. We're going to ask Jeff Thorek to pull together booster representatives and really go through this to see if anything jumps out at them as a protocol that doesn't feel quite acceptable, but it's very straightforward and it's found to be very workable in a lot of other places. And it's, again, athletics and co-curriculars. So that's as far as we've gotten at this point. Next meeting, I would note that there's a date change. I think that comes up later. And so I'll dig that out and say it at the right time. But we plan to hear feedback from the booster organizations and also start to consider a gift policy that kind of ties it all together about the board's overall oversight of monies coming to the school. So
I would encourage board members and members of those kinds of organizations to go ahead and read these policies and give your feedback to Barbara. It can come through me, but it's perfectly acceptable to go to the...
And booster organizations through Jeff Thorek, who will be present at the next meeting, or Jeff Shedd, certainly, for music boosters. So
we've also asked our principals to share with their parent associations, because there are some of the fundraising guidelines that talk about school-affiliated fundraising.
Yes, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to item 6F, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the athletic staff nominations as outlined in this evening's packet materials. You want me to read them?
Quickly.
Sure. So Daniel Weeks, baseball 8th grade, Christopher Drake, lacrosse boys 7th grade, and Sarah Jordan, lacrosse girls 8th grade.
I'll second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. And item 6G, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendations for administrator probationary contract renewals for the 2016-2017 school year. Do I need to do all that?
We have to
just for the two individuals.
We have to say their names.
But just so that, I just didn't know all those little.
Oh, you can skip the last.
You can skip the last.
Which includes Nate Carpenter from the high school, assistant principal, and Teresa Curran, assistant principal at Palm Cove.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6H, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the high school VEX robotics team trip to the VEX World Championship in Louisville, Kentucky, April 20th through the 23rd, 2016.
That's fun.
I second. Any discussion? Do you want to just update, does everybody, the standard, everybody has the opportunity to participate?
But those members who qualified, so the teams that qualified for the World Championship are eligible to participate, and there are some fundraising efforts underway, and there is some money in our co-curricular funding that supports that level of competition.
Great. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6I, may have a motion, please.
I move that we approve the nomination of the new personnel beginning, a new personnel for special education, director of special education beginning in 2016, effective July 1st. I read this so crazily, for Jessica Clark. Sorry. I could read it again if you want me to.
Second.
Good enough.
We know what you mean.
Okay, exactly.
Any discussion?
We are very excited to have a fabulous candidate come on board.
Yeah, I can speak more briefly. It's my pleasure to nominate Jessica for this position. Jessica comes to us with a bachelor's degree from the University of Connecticut, a master's degree in education from Simmons College, and a certificate of advanced studies degree from the University of New Hampshire. She's a board-certified behavior analyst who has worked as an administrator for the New England Center for Children over the last several years. She has worked as a special educator and has a vast degree of experience in working with children and families. The committee was impressed by her, her enthusiasm and her energy and her commitment, to serving children and families.
I would just note that in our packet, the references spoke really highly of her, and it was very exciting to read those.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item 7, committee reports. Do we have any committee reports?
I'm going to wait for the next meeting.
Okay. Item 8, are there any school board agenda requests?
I'll just note that the evaluation committee will be presenting at the next meeting. That's a prior request, but
okay.
Something that we had scheduled as the pilot winds down.
Thank you.
Current pilot.
Item 9, announcements of upcoming meetings.
Yes, I'll announce that policy, instead of the first Monday of the month this time, in deference to my being out of state, we're moving it to Thursday, the 7th at 7:30 in the Jordan Conference Room. Policy Committee, 7:30, April 7th.
Thank you.
That's a.m.
I'm so happy to hear that you're keeping up with the 7:30 a.m. tradition.
I roll out
so
of my coffee and run.
Oh, wonderful.
That's right.
Joe?
Sure. So the next budget meeting is next Tuesday, 3:15 at 6:30 in the high school library. It will be taped, but not for simulcast. On the agenda for that evening will be athletics, CIP, facilities, transportation, staff and student support, and the office of the superintendent. We would appreciate any email questions that you may have about those budget centers. All of the budget materials are online. If you could forward me any questions or comments by Thursday the 10th in the evening, I will compile those and send them on to our superintendent so that she can distribute those and get answers for thoughtful consideration for next Tuesday evening's meeting. We're also still accepting questions for any of the points and topics that were covered the week before, and I believe that was, we covered staffing and benefits, Ponco Middle School and High School, technology and instructional support on Tuesday, March 1st. So if you also have questions about those, we want to forward those along because we didn't have an interim point in between them. And I just want to remind everyone to please mark on your calendars that although they were put down as tentative dates, that we are indeed scheduling out March 17th and March 24th as budget meetings since we had a late start. And for the forever changing landscape, the MSMA put out an email today we might get more money. So there are worse problems to solve, so no complaints there. And that's it.
I'm going to quickly remind the board to check email and remember that we have some NIAS committee commitments if you're able to be there, and Jeff Shedd has provided us with those dates. I would like to just put one more plug in that the Advisory Screening Committee is meeting tomorrow. That is 3-9, and I know it's quick, but we are also meeting on Monday the 14th. So tomorrow's meeting is in Jordan Conference Room. The Monday meeting is in one of the large conference rooms in the library.
Times on both.
6:30 tomorrow and 6 o'clock on Monday.
PM.
Thank you.
PM.
Any other announcements of upcoming meetings? Seeing none. Item 10, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we adjourn.
A second?
All those in favor? Thank you.
Very good.